Thank you. سيم نشلتش سيم نشلوقا نسلايكن تسقيل يخت سي اتيتين هو نيل تلاك تسقيل تشلينين تسقيل كسلسيلة تسقيل كتشلامق أكويق إكستابيق نيل تسقيل أساس خيم توا تيتشل سقيل أوس نيل تخيلنو وشتيلنو شتيلة قل قلسن كتشي أثلاك وخلطك أثلي سكويس كسنة شلئة كسنة مين كسنة سلسيلة نجامق أكويق إكستابيق نيل تسقيل أثسقيل إلا كتشي سي ثنا مين لا توا خيلنو ليث اتليشس نيل تلقاوس ستات خيلنو إلا تيتنو سو قول قول سكسنا مين لا إلا تيثن شواقوا تليك تسخيسس قل صالمتشن تسنيس قال سالمتشن هيك سكتشيه تسني اوسو وايل تسني كنتي سلي لي اكسس كويس ستيلمس اكسس كويس كوينانغتس كنتي سكتشيه سلي سكيله شواقوستا نيس شايستا تسكتشيه تنتا قل قيلياس كسنا منلا اكسن سلسيلا Ixalako skela lako song as a singing in it. Nis could say, said Justin. Achang sa mainsta, equis chalesta. Nisa could say, quant xamok sting, oxathesis, oxqualang sik one oxas xamok sting. Hegs could say this nis, nis Justin Qualinson, nis nis later. So test at the tongue of his whole query as lark or song, so illic, so see last. Test at the chatting, mock or hinge wars. Hanating snills ask got there. It low lay in legs as quite sniss. Sinus creek which I say. Thou quintisk some mock sting. Quintisk as waste squills. Quintis x squares chase, x squares stealems. Tus kuche, a sayer. Stkaya. Sestkaya, thou not a squawkwaster, this higher squaw was sayer. Our kuche so high sayer. Thou lakes of Clucknich, eggs of spares, eggs of mug sting, lays the chalock. Nist slays, salelukla, lay let us the skin exesk, thong ex heisks, etla sidia tongu, e nis hamku eat slay, haneting stkaya. Hegs could say at the snees, heg. Tasak sanatra squechali qualkulsa suksan square and gangada. Nilsa kusquawis slitkas kuntiuk sais naponaks kusal elu kuschalesta. Ethos kuchaeth and gangana asae. Nilst squash the chalangan. Nilst squash the snaponak sae. Hegs kus ethos kusangana. Nis ut atus honengsta se, heiks kuchetene quilia. My dear friends and relatives, I want to thank you for being here tonight. I'm going to talk to you about a time when there was only what they call the first part of creation. The human beings were the last to be created, and my father carved this to tell our story. The human being is always at the bottom because he was the last to be created. Us humans, we were asked to watch and to observe everything that was around us. And our great-great-grandparents pointed to the water. Look at the ocean, look at the water. Your brother's out there. His name is Khalsalamachin. He's called the killer whale. It's not true. He is not a killer whale. He is a spirit of our ancestors. And the spirit he has is the one we carry. He has a song. You children have to remember the songs of these people that come from the ocean, whether it is the killer whale or the sea lion or the many citizens that lie in the ocean that have a story to tell us human beings. So as my father began to talk about this, because my father learned this from his grandmother, grandfathers, and all those people before him. The other one he went to called the eagle. The story of the eagle talks about a time when this bird flew the sky and saw everything that needed to be seen and took care of the people. And this bird, the eagle, has a song. And when you hear his song, you'll hear him. And it means that's a message for our people to become aware that there is another world to be looked at. And this eagle has his own song also. We come to the land that we walk on. Many times as we walk on this earth, we see different things. But this one is special to our people. In the English language, they call him a serpent. In our language, we call him Sinasqi. He's a spirit, he has a voice, he has a song that belongs to our children and belongs to our family. Every one of us humans have this gift, but our people, the people of the Lummis and the Coast Salish people, carry those songs to this day. So we tell these stories to our children to remind them of our relationship to one another, of the land, the sky, and the water. Then we come to the wolf. The wolf is our oldest teacher of what a family is about. It is not only the wolf, it is the mountain lion, the Klachnich, they call him. These two, as well as the bear, they too have a spirit. And many times throughout the winter, we see these spirits dance in our homes. And these are called Stqeya, Klachnich, and Speth. These are the things that we had to learn because we had to have a relationship not only with our human people, but also the spirit of the first part of creation. At the time of creation, these were all human beings because they were here before us. We had to learn how to live with each one of these things, because if we didn't learn, then we would become poor in our own way. So they sang the songs that belonged to each one of these spirits and each one of these brothers. We call them Chwalqua. These are our brothers. Whether they're in the ocean, on the land, or in the sky, or in the rivers, these are the things that we had to protect. And our grandparents said to us, remember, remember, this is who we are. This is who we will always be. Never, never let your children forget who they are. This is who we are.
Good evening. My name is Charles Wilkinson. I'm Moses Lasky Professor of Law at the University of Colorado. In the 1400s, as they were laying their plans for conquest, Europeans turned their attention to indigenous peoples. These men of religion had never personally met any natives, but they were absolutely certain of their superiority over them. Kings, popes, and theoreticians all questioned the very humanity of Indian people. Are they human? Their basic conclusion was probably, but of a low order. They didn't follow the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. They were uncivilized. As one put it, they take their life from the land like animals. In the 1500s, Spanish and Portuguese theoreticians and Roman Catholics and canon law scholars debated the question of the rights of indigenous peoples. Most of them found that they had no rights, none at all. One who felt otherwise was Francisco de Victoria, the eminent scholar who did find that they had a right to governance. Today we call it sovereignty, and a right to land. But even the generous de Victoria referred to them as barbarians. In American colonial history, the colonies showed a measure of compassion and morality by acknowledging Indian land title and by insisting that there be no land transactions with Indians without the consent of the tribes. After the American Revolution, the young nation made treaties with Indian tribes, but the treaties rested on the doctrine of discovery developed by the European theologians. Under the doctrine of discovery, the mere presence of European nations on this continent, and later the United States, diminished and lessened the land rights of Indian tribes by putting above them a superior federal right. The most critical time in Indian affairs was the 19th century. And during virtually the whole century, in foreign affairs, domestic affairs, a top priority was obtaining vast landscapes of Indian lands for the United States. The United States went so far as to declare it possessed a manifest destiny ordained by God to go to the Pacific, capture that land, and open it for homesteading. The dream of Americans was the Jeffersonian ideal that we would be fully a society of yeoman farmers, their families, and their communities. And with all that, our country, for all of its talk of liberty and equality, could not find a place for peoples who sustainably harvested and thanked their creator for the bison, the elk, the deer, the camas, the acorns, the wild onions, the wild carrots, the sea lions, the clams, and the salmon. There would be treaty making, and it was said it would be with the consent of the tribes. But the nation would move westward. The tribes would give land. Indian people would become Christians and farmers. This was official policy. And the treaties would be negotiated by able Americans who knew exactly what they wanted to obtain. In 1853, President Franklin Pierce made a momentous decision in the history of the Pacific Northwest. The Washington Territory was new, and the governor of the territory would have jurisdiction over Washington, Idaho, and western Montana. It was a powerful position with few limits, and the number one priority was to negotiate treaties with Indian tribes for land. The decision that President Pierce made was to appoint as governor Isaac Stevens, a West Point graduate. And Stevens became one of the most important figures in the history of the American West, as well as the Pacific Northwest. Isaac Stevens, driven, ambitious, hard-nosed, and willing to make whatever promises were needed, knew exactly what he wanted to get. In the name of the United States of America, full and clear title to as many acres as could possibly be obtained from Indian tribes in the Pacific Northwest.
Governor Stevens, how was your journey from Washington, D.C.?
Most interesting, gentlemen.
I understand you've been charged with surveying a new route for the railroad.
Opening up a rail line to the west will speed access to the Washington territories and open it up for settlements as well. This is a land of great opportunity, gentlemen, great opportunity. There's rumors of great mineral wealth here as well.
As long as we can reach an agreement with the native population. Do you anticipate the speedy negotiations?
We successfully subdued the natives east of the mountains, and we will conclude these treaty negotiations with due dispatch as well.
In your report of 1854, you mentioned the toll the diseases such as smallpox, cholera, measles, not to mention alcohol, have taken on the native populations. Perhaps they will die out on their own.
The speedy extinction of this race seems more to be hoped for than regretted, gentlemen.
They do seem indifferent themselves as to whether they live or die, and they are predisposed to every kind of vice.
Gathering them onto a few large reservations may prove difficult, since there are many small, independent tribes with varying languages and customs.
By uniting them, many small groups under one chief and severely limiting their land, they will learn to tolerate one another. Of course, we'll have to curtail trade and commerce with the natives to the north and Canada. Indians are never so exposed to mischief as when they are scattered and beyond control.
Governor, you sit here, sir.
Thank you.
I understand the Lubbee tribe on North Bellingham Bay has been especially troublesome.
Indeed. We'll be meeting with the four chief designated to represent the entire coast, and I'll be meeting with this Chowitsut from the Lummies to ensure their special cooperation.
What if they will not sign? What if they are unwilling to give up their lands and territory?
Nonsense. They're coming here with the express purpose to sign. I will deal with them as I've dealt with other tribes in the past. Gentlemen, they will sign or they'll walk knee-deep in blood. The civilization of the Indian and their incorporation into this territory, that's our great end.
This is a great undertaking, Governor. I hope negotiations go smoothly.
These measures are for their benefit. In the end, they will be assimilated and subdued, or they will be eliminated.
We welcome the people from the Lummi country. We have waited for 2 days, and now we will hear from the Lummi chief.
I am Chowitsut, chief of the Lummi. Your messenger came to us about 2 moons ago and told us of your plans for this council. I am glad to see that my friends the Swinomish are here and the Samish. I and my people are ready to listen to your plan.
We welcome the people from the Lummi country. We have been for 2 days meeting with the Duwamish and Snoqualmie. They've counseled with me and your friends from the Skagit and Swinomish. We have agreed that there's room in this great land of yours for the red man and the white man to live together peacefully as brothers. So we have made papers to show our good faith, and we believe that you are here to help us finish these papers today.
White chief, we have seen some of the white people you speak of. We can trust them to live with us on the land, but there are certain areas that are sacred to my people, such as our homelands, our hunting and fishing grounds. Our young must have land for their homes in the future. Here are the providers of my tribe. They will speak.
I am a hunter for my people. Was taught by my father and my uncle. Their father taught them. They have sent me here today to speak to you. They taught me the habits and migrations of all that the Creator provides for the Lummi people. Take ducks in the lowlands, take deer, elk, and bear, distribute them amongst the people as our customs dictate. The hills, forests, and meadows abound with food for the Lummi people. We thank the Creator for all He provides for the Lummi people. We thank the deer, elk, and bear for giving up their life that we may live.
I am a fisherman for my Lummi people. Been sent here by the old one, the old fisherman. Tell you I'm Falang. I've been taught as a young man to be a fisherman. Wake up in the morning. Listen to the leaves. Listen to the rustle of the trees. Watch the clouds. And that dictates where you'll fish that day. I've been taught to fish the yamich, the king salmon, in the early spring. In the mid-summer months, I've been taught by the older fishermen how to build one of the greatest gifts that the sockeye has given us, the reef net. This way of fishing, we only take what we need and release the rest unharmed. We have these great traps in Point Roberts, Cherry Point, Lummi Island, Lopez Island, San Juan Island. And in the early, early spring, go out in the open waters to catch the mighty halibut. In the fall, late fall, we fish the rivers.
What we eat?
To catch the chum salmon that we smoke and put away to provide for our children and our elders throughout the winter. I fished these places with my father, and his, as he did with his father. And these papers, do they guarantee my people to fish with their future generations? I've been told to come here and tell you about Shillangan.
I am the sea lion hunter from my Lummi people. The Creator has gifted us, my great-great-grandfathers from Semiamu, Nooksack, and Lummi, my grandfathers, my father, as I will teach my son, will travel through the seas from as north as Tawasin, Cherry Point, Semiamu, out to the farthest islands, down to the South Sea, Puget Sound. These are the gifts that I carry. These are the gifts of me and my hunters. We listen to the sounds of the water. We follow the fish runs. We're the sea wolf people. We're taught by killer whale. We're watched by the sun, by the eagles. To travel to village sites, to understand the languages of our own people. Through our catches, we share with them to make sure that they're abundant. Throughout the winters, they are plentiful. They have plenty to eat. We don't take more than our share. I pray the words from my people who aren't able to make it here are being heard today.
I am the clam digger for the Lummi people. I represent many, many people who use the moon when it's full in the springtime as we travel north to Point Roberts to dig the horse clam on the big tide. When the tide is out, they say, our table is set. We follow our fishermen and our leaders and our hunters in their footsteps. Yes, we may be weak, but what is a nation that has no weak? Since I was a young boy, I learned from my mother, who learned from her mother and her grandmother, from time immemorial, that time and tide wait for no man. We learn this from the clam. This is our Shillangan. This is our way of life.
I am the gatherer for our Lummi people. In the spring, I go into the woods to harvest the nettles and the sprouts. And in the summer, I climbed the great mountain called Shan to pick the huckleberries, the blueberries. And when I see an abundant harvest of the salmon berry, I know that my brother will have a good salmon season. When I gather and bring the food and the medicine of the plant people to my home, I know that it will give my family refreshment and healing. This is the gift, the sacred gift that was given us by the Creator and has been passed down from one generation to the next. And this sacred gift we guard.
My children.
You
are not my children because you are the fruit of my loins. But children for whom I have the same feeling as if you were the fruit of my loins.
Sure.
I saw among you yesterday the sign of the cross, which I believe to be the most holy of signs. Therefore, I will address you as Christians who know that this life is preparation for the life to come. The great father in Washington thinks you ought to have homes and schools so your children can learn to read. He made fathers and taught trades. He is willing that you still catch fish in the waters and gather roots and berries in the mountains. He wishes you to be virtuous and industrious and to become a happy and prosperous community.
Each would connect.
This is this good? Do you want this?
Each would connect.
What is it?
I follow it.
My friend has reminded me of something I had forgotten. You shall also have a doctor to help you care for your bodies.
Each sweats, slackens, liquor, and flame.
Very well. In consideration of the above session, the United States agrees to pay these tribes $150,000 in the following manner, that is to say. For the first year, $15,000. For the next 2 years, $12,000 each year. For the next 4 years, $7,500 each year. And for the next 5 years, $6,000 each year. And for the last 5 years, $4,250 each year. If the Great Father, for the benefit and welfare of the tribe, deems it necessary that you should be relocated, you will be required to be relocated to a general reservation. You will be remunerated for any improvements you've made to the land and for the expenses of moving. These promises will be kept by the Americans for as long as the sun shines, as long as the mountain stands, and as long as the river runs. Chief Seattle, will you be the first to sign?
Our Neskiyas Kunis Hollet to Nisnet, I said, people. Squiamps to sell elops to Farmkum, Kusni, Kahalatum, Ini Yathistum to sell. Liquor. Nich quiet. A tennis qualmo, the stitty one. Eat at a water. E lalamitis. Fee lalam. E hile cocked in e knee. Eat at a western. Nich hotter. Could see it at a tall. Limit. The non square. Fee slumo, hamitus tennis mistimo. The words you say would not help my people. My heart is shaking. The words you say, you speak, it comes out and it goes different ways. The words. Very, very uncertain. You say you're going to give us a school.
My children are already in school. My nephews and nieces are already teaching. The sun comes up and school starts. And the sun goes down and school is finished as they teach how to hunt, how to fish, how to pick berries, how to preserve the food. The air, the ocean. Our ancestors listened to them. They listened to the plant. They give our my people advice. We talked with the animals. That's our family. You cannot be my father. You cannot be my father. Your God is not my God. Your God.
It's been 70 years since the Treaty of Point Elliott was signed in 1855. On February 12, 1925, United States Congress passed a jurisdictional act allowing numerous Indian tribes to bring suit against the United States for perceived violations of the Treaty of 1855. In this petition, 155 Indians testified. Many of them had been alive when the Treaty of Point Elliott had been signed. Among them were 10 Lummies. Following is some of their testimony.
Councilor Griffin, state your case.
We are here to bring the claims of the Lummi people that the United States did not hold true to the terms of the 1855 treaty. Our claims regard the size of the reservation, compensation for villages and homes lost or abandoned, and compensation for promised allotments of land. For example, Your Honor, Lummi people were promised 80 acres each, or 160 acres per couple. However, Lummi people were given 7 acres each, while white settlers were given 320 acres each.
Councilor Stormont, your response?
The defense states that the language of the Treaty of 1855 is clear and unambiguous and leaves no room for interpretation. There were efforts made, it appears, to make sure that it was clear to the Indians who were present the content of the treaty by the use of translators or the use of the Chinook jargon as a common language.
Chinook.
It is also clear that it was understood, at the very least, by Chief Seattle, the oldest Indian present.
Let us hear testimony from the Lummi claimants.
Seattle. Nees to me, Makaltio, Huyanet to Squaw, Governor Stevens. It's in Sleekas. He needs Thakatim to Squaw. CMS to Nemestimu, Nishwalakwa. Open Ik to Thilelum. He needs nuts a mat, it's a water. The squaw needs thakatu. When you say, our chief tsewit to the squalmo. I was there, Makaltio, when the treaty was brought forth. We had 19 beautiful longhouses. our people was rich, and the treaty come in, and the promises haven't been brought forth. I listened with my heart as you just now spoke, and you said Chief Seattle was part of this, and I remember he was the only one pleading not to put his mark on that paper. You covered my people with blankets, and they got sick. Smallpox destroyed my people. You burned two beautiful homes because of that sickness. Cherry Point, I am concerned about that sacred place. We hold that place very valuable. Birch Bay, you burned two longhouses. You white people destroyed all our homes. And now people are suffering.
Longhouses have been used by my people for generations.
They eat.
We kept our homes in good repair. These homes were not owned by the families who lived in them.
Much weight.
They were owned by the whole village because we all worked together to build them. Our homes were built the same as our relatives in our neighboring villages. Same as in Macaw, Duwamish, Stillaguamish, Skagit, Sklallams, San Juan Islands. Our homes were very large, 8 or 9 families dwelling in each longhouse.
Who's the eat?
The longhouses were 36 feet wide. Where are these homes now? I'm sorry, but we have changed the way we live to accommodate the white man. I am Lummi. I know what I'm talking about. You are a white man, and I'm sorry, but you do not understand our customs of ownership.
We were there as young boys when the boundary lines of the Lummi Reservation were drawn back in 1855. Our reservation is smaller than it was when it was originally set. Before the treaty, our people used to live as far as the eye could see that way, to the Great Kulshan, Mount Baker, all the way up through Cherry Point, to Point Roberts, and throughout the islands was our traditional territory. Our land has been given away by the treaty. And today, it's given away piece by piece.
Do you, Lummi, know of any other matters relative to the claims in question? If you do, state it.
When our people signed the treaty in 1855, we were there. You little boys. And we remember hearing the old ones ask, Governor Stevens, will you remember these promises that you have made to us? And he pointed to the mountain and he said, do you see that mountain? That mountain is big. And then he pointed to the river, and he said, do you see that river over there? That river forever flows in one direction. And then he pointed out to the bay, and he said, do you see that bay? Every day the tide floods in and ebbs out forever. And then he pointed up at the sun, and he said, that sun forever shines. It rises and sets
Forever. And then he said, these four that I mentioned will be witnesses to guarantee these promises that I have made to you. That is what he said. We're here to tell you that the mountain is still here. The rivers are still here. The sun still shines. And the tide still ebbs and floods. We have been strung along for 70 years by Governor Stephen. We want a settlement immediately while we are still alive.
Well, very well. Your testimony is duly noted. We will make a decision very soon. Court has considered all of the causes of action brought by the Lummi people. Some of these causes are with merit, such as Lummi children being promised an education that they have not yet received. And some causes are not with merit, such as the current size of the reservation. As a nomadic people with no sense of personal property, we cannot give value to what you claim you have lost. Finally, the court is entitled to set-offs and counterclaims for this process, which means we can deduct any amount of your settlement for the operation of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, which has operated in your behalf for your protection and your prosperity. The Lummi people have claimed $4 million in damages for the causes of action described in this suit. Yet, the set-offs of the Bureau of Indian Affairs far exceed that amount, and that of all the claims of the Lummis. Therefore, this entire case and the claims will be dismissed.
And much has happened since the claims case was dismissed in 1927. There are some things we need to know. The 1950s and 1960s marked the era of the termination policy in Congress, the idea being to sell off the reservations one by one, to pay off the Indian people with the proceeds, and to end once and for all what people called the Indian problem. The harshness of termination was furthered by other statutes and regulations.
The atmosphere was bad for Indian people. It was toxic during these years. The tribe came back to court after the dismissal of the first claim by filing in 1951 another claim.
Explanation in our history that we've witnessed since 1974. I'd like to introduce who was our chairman at that time in the Lummi Indian Business Council. My name is Ramona Morse. Indian name is Hayolitza. At this time, I'd like to introduce our chairman, Larry Kinley. Larry, could you please stand and be recognized in front of you? Thank you, Larry. Also like to introduce Henry Hilaire. He's our senior council member. He's been on the Lummi Tribal Council for many, many years. He was also, he's coming.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure proud that you're able to attend this, and I'm proud to be here. It was in the years of the Hitler trying to put the stop to our desire to search for the promises that were made to us, so I put the year on and stop Hitler. But here I am back here again, waiting for them promises that were made. And they signed a treaty. And I thank you, and I'm glad to be here.
Thank you, Penny. So we served on a tribal council for many years, and I lost my spot. Thank you. Well, anyway, with our tribal council at the time consisted of 11 tribal members, that we were really all very involved in this Docket 110. Docket 110 was not a surprise to us because it's been on the books with Congress for quite a few years. And when they appointed the land commission to deal with the federal government, in America, Congress called the Indian land mess. We felt that was not our land mess. We felt when the Lands Claim Commission made that offer to us of $57,000, we felt on a tribal council, we reviewed the legislation, we reviewed why they were offering such a low, low price in our minds, because they did not consider our aboriginal lands. They did not consider our islands where we hunted and fished since our aboriginal traditional times. None of that was even considered by them. We felt the commission just wanted to do what was commanded of them, settle the Indian mess, the land mess. Well, it hasn't been settled yet today. We still are in debate about our fee to trust. That is still an existing problem. That also consists of our lands that's never been settled. We totally and completely refused that $57,000. To this day, each council since that 74 date has refused that money. That's why it's sitting in the trust fund. drawn interest. There's a condition to that fund. We can't receive that money until we come up with a plan, and that plan consists of, we cannot use that funds to purchase land. That's forbidden. This also reminds me of the late Sam Cagey was on a council at that time. Vernon Lane was on the council at that time. Very strong individuals, very outspoken individuals, very smart individuals. We all worked very closely together. So we passed this resolution on a tribal council, refusing this money, because that condition stated we cannot purchase land with this money. We must have a different plan. We could not use it to suit the needs of our people in our tribe. So that was just totally unacceptable to us. Also, the late Sam Cagey wrote a very strong letter to the Lands Commission, refusing the funds, explaining why we refused. To this day, we still have problems with the fee to trust. Through the Bureau of Indian Affairs and their policies, rules, and regulations, they don't favor our position. They have policies saying we have to pay. We just pay for 3 acres we just purchased. We have to pay another municipality money for the revenues that they're losing. This is, again, not acceptable to us, because the United States and America, as you heard Governor Stevens said, America would take care of you. I assume he's saying us, because that was the treaty we signed. The Point Elliott Treaty was signed considering and taking that what the United States government stated was a fact and a truth, and it would be promised as carried out. These promises were many, as you heard, our hunting, our fishing, our housing. These promises, Governor Stevens state, you heard, Americans will take care of you. It hasn't happened. It hasn't come true. In all phases of what you heard tonight. This is why, as Aboriginal people of this land and this country, we're not giving up. We're not going away. We're going to stay here. We're going to work together. Yes. We are going to become like the great Grand Spirit tells us to be. Together, we can solve this problem. We can finish this division. We have to educate each other. We have to become very knowledgeable as Indian people in how congressional people work. We must become understanding. You and the rest of the country that call themselves American also must be understanding. We can be understanding together. We don't have to be divided. We have to be like, I don't know, Governor Stevens' civilization. Today, we're not walking in blood knee deep. We are walking in policies, regulations, procedures, laws that was created, not all for our benefit. We're walking knee deep in those kind of things, not in our blood. And we're also being assimilated, but we're not being eliminated. We're being so assimilated, we even have a roundabout coming on a reservation.
Ocean.
We might even have 2 or 3 coming. But assimilation and elimination are 2 different things in our minds. We can work together. We all are Americans. Thank you.
States government has determined that after all what has already been paid and considering the fair market value of the Lummi tract, the Lummi are indeed entitled to a settlement. We offer you the sum of $57,067.07. Sign here.
What about the homes we had to destroy?
What about those promises?
What about the homes that were burned because of sickness and disease?
What about those promises?
What about the size of our reservation, which is way far smaller than our ancestral land? How about that?
What about those promises?
What about allotment for every Lummi? What about those promises?
The treaty wasn't our idea, but the sun still rises. Mountain is still there and the river still flows. Those are the witnesses to those promises.
What about those promises? What about those promises? What about those promises? What about those promises?
Thank you so much. There's one final word I'd like to say to everyone, especially the youth. You know, we all have so much to learn, so much to understand. Sometimes the history books we have in our schools are not the real history. So we have to do our research. We have to learn that we're going to live together forever. None of us are going away. So we have to help those that teach our children some of the truths and some of the facts that we as Indian people, we are the original owners of this country. We are the Aboriginal people. We are traditionally, culturally, everything that you witnessed this evening. We are here to stay. Whether we live on a postage stamp or not, we're going to be here. We're not going to wait. We're going to be working with whoever needs to be talked to, educated. We have many friends in Congress, non-Indians, others that are advocates for us, that understand, take the time to learn who we really are. We got to teach ourselves the true history of this famous country. I'm so proud to be a Native American and also American. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Come on, folks.
So, come on.